This subject will open the Bible up for you by shedding new light on the mystery of creation. Once this subject is understood, the Bible will read like a new book. So, let's follow Pastor Cox as he unfolds the story of creation.
Mind long before creation was begun, he had me on his mind long before a bird had ever sung, and long before the sky and sea, before the world was born, he thought of you and me. He even knew my name long
Thank you, Maddie. All of us at Christmas time celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. We sing such songs as Joy to the World, The Lord has come, let earth receive her King. And most of us believe that that was the beginning of Jesus Christ. We believe that he was born in Bethlehem, and that was the start of Jesus. Tonight, I'd like for us to look at a truth in God's Word that can just open up the Scriptures and shed light on it that will make it new, will make it fascinating, and will bring out truths in many, many ways that you and I have never seen before. Jesus was talking to the Jewish people, to the Pharisees in his day, and he said this to them, "You search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." Now, folks, when he's talking to the Jewish leaders there, and he tells them that you're searching the Scriptures, and he says, "These are they which testify of me," he's not talking about New Testament Scriptures, because the New Testament hadn't been written. So when he makes that statement, he has to be talking about Old Testament Scriptures. And he says, "These are the ones that testify about me." What's he trying to tell them? As he continued to talk to these Jewish leaders, discussing things with them, he had this to say. "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." Talking to him, and he said, "Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he was glad that he saw it." Now listen, they don't understand what's going on here. They can't quite put that together, because their answer is this. "And then the Jews said to him, 'You are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham?'" They said, "You're not even 50 years old. Are you trying to tell us that you have seen Abraham?" Now, folks, watch carefully, because he's fixing to say something that these Jewish leaders were totally unprepared to accept, and something that you and I, if you see it clearly tonight, will open up God's Word. Listen to what he says. "And Jesus said to them, 'Most assuredly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am.'" Oh. Now, when he said "before Abraham was," that was one thing. But when he said "before Abraham was, I am." Oh. You see, everything that these people were fighting against, all of a sudden, he put that all in front of them, because he said, "I am." That term, "I am," used in the Scripture, meant that he was God. And boy, it turned those people on him so bad that this is what took place. And then they took up stones to throw at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. I mean, they were ready to stone him to death right there, because he said, "Before Abraham was, I am. I existed." He's saying that he was God, and that he existed before Abraham of old existed. How long? How long before Abraham did Jesus exist? Well, the Scripture tells us that he existed before this world. It says before this world was ever created that he existed. "And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you before the world was." Said, "Glorify me with the glory that I had with you before this world was." Before the world even existed, Jesus Christ existed. In fact, he goes on and says that he existed from the beginning. Way back. From the beginning, Jesus Christ existed. "The Lord possessed me at the beginning of his ways, before his works of old. I have been established from everlasting, from the beginning, before there was ever an earth." He said, "I existed before the earth ever came into existence." That's why in the book of Hebrews you find Jesus saying that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That he existed clear from the beginning. It says that he is God. In fact, he says that he has existed from everlasting. But you, Bethlehem Ephratah, though you are little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you shall come forth to me the one to be the ruler in Israel. Listen. Whose going forth has been from old, from everlasting, without beginning. Without beginning and without end. He has existed from everlasting. Now, folks, when you begin to get that clear in your mind, that Jesus Christ existed from everlasting and all the way down through and into eternity he will exist, then when you pick up God's Word, and then when you begin to read it, all of a sudden you will see things about Jesus Christ that you never realized before. That's what he was talking about when he said, "These are they which testify of me." Because he was there. He existed before the world was created. In fact, the scripture goes on and tells us that he's the one that created this world, Jesus Christ. Listen, Genesis 1, verse 1. This is what it says about the creation. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. What does it mean, God? Is it talking about God the Father? Or is it talking about God the Son? Or is it talking about God the Holy Spirit? Which is it talking about? See, you have to establish that when it uses the word God. Because the word God applies to the Father. It applies to the Son. It applies to the Holy Spirit. And the Scripture helps you put that together so that you know exactly who it's talking about. Because in the Gospel of John, the first chapter, verse 1, watch as it begins to explain this. And in the beginning was the Word, all right? And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Putting it together? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Watch verse 3 or 2. He was in the beginning with God, the Word was. All things. Get it clear. All things were made through him. That means the Word. And without him, nothing was made that was made. It says that all things were made by the Word, that the Word was in the beginning, and that it was with God, and it was God. Now let's see if the Scripture will tell us who that Word is. Because verse 14 tells us exactly who that Word is. And the Word became flesh, dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So it tells us that that Word is Jesus Christ. And it says that he was in the beginning with God, and that he was God. And it says that all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Dear friends, if you can set that in your thinking, when you pick up God's Word, you're going to see things in God's Word in the Old Testament that you never realized before, as you understand that it was Jesus Christ that was there in the creation of this world. All of a sudden, the Word of God takes upon itself a stability that you have never seen before when you find that Jesus Christ is the one all the way through. You'll read text after text that'll come to life. Watch. As this is talking about Jesus creating the world. This is what it says. God, referring to the Father, who at various times and in different ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets. It's saying God the Father spoke in times past by to the fathers or to the prophets. Now watch. Has in these last days spoken to us by his Son. Has spoken to us by his Son. Now watch as he makes a tremendous statement. whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds. He made the what? Not just this world. He made the worlds. His Son, Jesus Christ, created the worlds. It was Jesus Christ that formed this earth and brought it into existence. When you come down to the end there in Genesis where he created the world, and it says that he looked out over all of his creation and he says, it is very good. It's talking about Jesus Christ. He's the one that made it. Now, if you can begin to put that all together, as you read through the scripture, you're going to see things come to life. When you get into Isaiah, and it talks about the everlasting Father, the mighty Prince, the Counselor, it's all talking about Jesus Christ. It's describing him and all of his power. But to the Son, he says, your throne, what? Who's he talking to? Come on, who's he talking to? The Son. And to the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. Jesus Christ, your kingdom is forever and ever. That he is God. It says that he did not think it robbery to be equal with God. Why? Because he existed back there with the Father from the beginning. He was one with God. He is the one that created and made this world. To make all people see what is the fellowship of the mystery which was from the beginning of the ages, has been hidden in God who created all things through Jesus. Now, folks, doesn't mean, when we pick up the Bible, it doesn't mean that God the Father wasn't there. Or it doesn't mean that the Holy Spirit wasn't there. They were. Because the scripture says that they said, let us create man in our image. So God the Father was there, so was the Holy Spirit. But it was through Jesus Christ the Son that he made the world. That's what it's saying. Through his Son, Jesus Christ, he made the world. He has existed from the beginning. You see, it's kind of hard for some people to get that clear, that the whole Bible is centered around Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about just New Testament. I'm talking about Old Testament. I'm talking about when you pick up the Bible and you read about the sanctuary service that we talked about the other night, where the Jewish people brought a lamb and they brought it to the sanctuary or to the tabernacle and they offered that lamb. I'm telling you tonight that everything about that service, the lamb, where they brought it, the temple or the sanctuary, the departments, every part of that sanctuary, all pointed to Jesus Christ. That's why he was trying to tell them, these are the scriptures that testify of me, created the world and made it. Yet for us there is only one God, the Father of whom are all things, and we for him, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we live. Now it says that everything that you and I have comes through Jesus Christ. What I'm trying to tell you tonight, dear friends, is this world exists because of Jesus Christ. You know, I've been trying to go about once a year to go over to Jerusalem, take a week or two, and just go there for my own study, my own edification, and just go there and visit the places and look and study and so forth. And I've been to Israel a number of times. I am absolutely convinced that if you were to reach in and take Jesus Christ out of Israel, the whole nation would crumble. It only exists today because of Jesus Christ. It would not exist if you took Christ out of it. Do you know what their number one source of income in Israel is? Tourism. More people go there and spend more money in Israel because of Jesus Christ. The whole economy circulates around every place you go, through the shops, all through Jerusalem. You know what they're selling? Jesus Christ. They exist because of Him. What I'm trying to get across to you tonight is that you and I exist tonight because of Jesus Christ. If you were to reach in and take Him out of this world, it would self-destruct. It's because of Him. He is the sustainer. He's the one that has made this, given us. He is the image. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. That's what He was trying to tell Philip when he said, Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father." And Jesus said, "Philip, if you have seen Me, you have seen the Father." He is the image of the invisible God. "For by Him all things were created, that are in heaven, that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through Him and for Him." So it says that everything that there is in heaven, on earth, the stellar heavens, everything that's out there, dear friends, was created by Jesus Christ. You see, some people have trouble with this. Science particularly. They want to talk about it coming into existence by some means. I have never been able to get that together. Just never been able to make it make sense for them to tell me that this world came into existence by some other process than a creator. When they tell me that it came into existence by chance, I have troubles with that. That's like telling me that a cyclone blew through a junkyard and out came a 747. That's what they're trying to tell me. I can't put that together, dear friends, when I can look at creation and I can see the hand of God as He created and made things. Created them in a special way. You know, I spoke one night in a place called Tucson, Arizona. And I mentioned about creation, and I talked about Jesus Christ being the creator and the earth and how He created it all. And after it was over, this young student, biology student, he was a upper division biology student, came up to me and he said, "Interested in what you had to say about creation." And I said, "I appreciate that." He said, "But I have troubles with that." And I said, "What do you have troubles with that?" He said, "Well," he said, "I don't understand how you can harmonize what you teach with the bristlecone pine tree." And I said, "Sorry, I don't know anything about the bristlecone pine tree." And he said, "Well," he said, "it's a pine tree." And he said, "That pine tree has, some of them have 12, 13, 14, 15,000 rings in them. And cut it in two." And he said, "Each one of those rings represents a year, so it tells that this earth is thousands of years old, not 6,000 years old." And he said, "What do you do with that?" And I said, "I don't know what to do with that." So I said, "But I'll find out." So that night when I got home, I called some friends of mine who are scientists. And I said, explain this to me, because I don't understand it. How do you put that all together? Well, one of them said to me, he said, now the reason that biology student is there is because the professor who's done all the work on the bristlecone pine tree is a professor at the University of Arizona. And he said, you need to take that student with you and you need to go see the professor. And he said, when you go see him, you ask him where the bristlecone pine tree grows. And he said, if he tells you that it grows on the timberline, then ask him if there is a very definite change in climate. Would it cause that tree to lay down a ring? And so we went to see the professor, had a nice visit with him. And I asked him, I said, where does this bristlecone pine tree grow? And he said, right up on the timberline. It's cold many times. And I said, you know, you have dramatic climate changes there. I said, does that have any effect on that tree? Would it cause it to lay down a ring? Oh, he said, no question about it. It probably lays down 4 and 5 rings a year. What I'm trying to get across, folks, is if you can get in your mind clear that when the Bible says that Jesus Christ was the Creator, that He's the one that created this world and made it, let me tell you what a difference it'll make. Do you understand what I'm talking about when I talk about the element chart that hangs in the chemistry room? You ever seen one of those? Well, they have a chart there. It has all the different elements on it. If you look at those elements, they have half-lives. Some of them have very long half-lives. Some of them have very short half-lives. Uranium has a very long half-life. They have found that they can identify these elements in rocks because those elements show up in rocks and they show up in color. And that particular element has a certain amount of energy, and so it would put off what we might call a alpha particle. And it goes out all the way around that particular element, and it causes what's called a halo around it. And some of those alpha particles have energy in them, and they put off another, what we would call a beta particle, and it causes another halo. And so when you look in a microscope at these elements that are in rocks, you will find them to be of a color, and they may have one halo, or they may have two. Now, what I'm getting at is some of those elements, folks, some of those elements have a very, very, very short half-life. For instance, one of them has a half-life of 1/100th of a second. That's all it lasts. It's gone. And yet, they have identified that in the rock. I don't know if you're getting what I'm telling you tonight. If we were to walk into this auditorium and it was pitch black, and I'm going to take a picture, and when I take the picture, the lens, the shutter in my lens, opens and closes before the flash goes off, what kind of picture am I going to get? Black. Not going to get a picture. Let's say that my flash goes off before the shutter opens and closes. What kind of a picture am I going to get? Yeah, it'd be black, at the very best, gray. Now, folks, what I'm trying to tell you is in order for that element to be captured in the rock so you can see it, it had to take place like that. Not by a process of thousands and thousands of years, but as Jesus Christ created it and spoke it into existence. He is the Creator. And once you get that clear, then tell you a great host of things clear up. And you begin to see what the Word of God is talking about. It's through Him that it was made, that it was created. All things were created through Him. And He is before all things, and in Him all things consist. He, Jesus Christ, is the one that sustains this earth. Let me tell you, dear friend, tonight you breathe because of Jesus Christ. You and I go about the things that we do because of Jesus Christ. He is the sustainer of your very life. We move and have our being in Him because He's the one that created this world and made it in the beginning. I can tell you tonight, nobody else makes that claim. No one else claims to exist before He came to this earth. Muhammad doesn't. Or Buddha. Or Confucius. None of them. Only Jesus Christ said that He existed before He was born here on earth. He was one with the Father. He was God. But He decided to come to this earth and take upon Himself our form, who being in the form of God, that's what He was, did not consider it robbery to be what? Equal with God. He was one in omnipotence. He was one in omniscience. He was one in omnipresence. He was with God. He was God. But for your sake and for mine, He decided He would become human. And He took the position of a son. He took the position of a son. But made Himself of no reputation, taking the form of a servant and coming in the likeness of men. That's how He came. And being found in the appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. That's what He did. That you and I might be saved. That we might have life. He became one of us. You see, if you're looking at an iceberg, all you're seeing is a very, very small portion of that iceberg. The tip of the iceberg. The rest of it's all beneath the water. If all you're looking at, friend, is the life of Jesus Christ on this earth, you're looking at a very, very small part. Because He existed back then with His Father. He decided to come to this earth and take upon Himself the form of mankind. Lived here and died for you and I. And now He exists with His Father to make intercession for you and me. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He came here. He came here on this earth. And He lived among man, and He gave great, great evidence that He was the Savior. Listen to this text. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by what? Miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through Him in your midst, as you yourselves also know. I mean, He came here and He lived on this earth for 30-some-odd years, and dear friends, He did untold miracles that man might see. Now, let me tell you something. If you take two things out of this book, it simply becomes philosophy. If you take two things out of it, if you take prophecy out of this book and you take miracles out of it, then the book will be nothing but philosophy. But once you put prophecy in there and you put miracles in there, this book becomes divine. Jesus said, "Believe on me for the things that I have told you. Believe on me for the things that I have told you." And they are recorded here. And he told them before they ever happened. The whole book of Revelation, he lays down one point after another that you and I might see that in him is one who is divine. Believe in me for the things I have told you. And he said, believe in me for the things that I have done. The miracles that he performed. You remember, there was a man by the name of Lazarus, a very, very close friend of Jesus Christ. He was sick. His sisters, Mary and Martha, sent word to Jesus and said, Lazarus is sick. The scripture says that Jesus ignored it for 2 days. And then he told his disciples that he had to go to wake Lazarus out of sleep. And you remember, he traveled for 2 days back to Bethany. And there he visited with Lazarus' sisters, Mary and Martha. And then he had him take him out to the tomb. This man has been dead 4 days. Now, when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Walked out there to that tomb, told him, roll away the stone. And then he said, Lazarus, come forth. And he who had died came out, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, loose him and let him go. And that man that had been dead for 4 days rose and came out of that grave. That miracle, up until that time, the Jewish leaders, the Sadducees and the Pharisees, had not been able to get their act together. But boy, when he called Lazarus from the grave, that miracle sent chills up their back. And they both turned on him and brought about his death. But I can tell you tonight, dear friends, you've got to do something with the book. Because the prophecies and the miracles of Jesus Christ stand as absolute witness to this day that he was the Son of God. That he alone is the Savior of this world. He attested by many miracles. It also says, therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may what? Take it again. Now I said, my Father loves me because I voluntarily said that I would become to this earth and that I would take upon myself the form of man and I would live here among man, and I would lay down my life for you. That's what he said. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself. And what I'm trying to tell you tonight, the resurrection of Jesus Christ stands as evidence that he is the Savior. Now, dear friends, there is more historical evidence tonight that there is a Jesus Christ than there is that there was a Julius Caesar. Whole lot more historical evidence of that. And the scripture says clearly that he is the one that created this world and made it. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Recognized by his Father in heaven, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." This Son that came to the earth took upon himself humanity, became one with us, will again go back to heaven where he will be one with the Father. The scripture describes him in these words: "But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed." Christianity has absolutely no meaning without Jesus Christ. Tonight, I would just simply tell you that if you have Jesus Christ, you've got everything. If you don't have him, you don't have anything. This world, is that what man wants? No, not me, friend. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Man goes his own way, contrary to God, but the Lord Jesus Christ took those iniquities and laid them on his Son, Jesus Christ, who paid that price for you and for me. He is God. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all in all. He's everything. Tonight, if you can just see that he was the Creator, that he existed in the beginning with his Father, when you pick up this book and you begin to read it, and you read about two angels and one like the Son of God that came to visit Abraham, you begin to understand that was Jesus Christ. When you read about Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego in the fiery furnace, and all of a sudden there was a fourth one that looked like the Son of God, you begin to understand that was Jesus Christ. And the whole Old Testament just begins to come alive, and you begin to see that it was Jesus all the way down through time that has been there ministering to man and caring for him. He, one with the Father, came to this earth and became one with us. Years ago, there was a man by the name of Timothy Dwight, who was the president of Yale University in the United States. Timothy Dwight was very, very highly respected by the people in his community. In fact, the people in the community looked upon him almost to the place that they revered him. I mean, everybody in the community just kind of looked upon him as being a leader, a guide in their community, and as one that they just all stood almost in awe of. And one day, a gentleman was walking down the street, down the sidewalk, and as he was, there was a boy playing there at the sidewalk, and he spoke to this boy, and he and the boy began to talk. And they started walking down the sidewalk, and this little boy and this man were just visiting together. And as they were walking down the sidewalk, this man looked up ahead, and down the sidewalk came Timothy Dwight. And this man immediately stopped, stepped off the sidewalk, and waited for Timothy Dwight to pass, and he hung his head, and when he passed, Timothy Dwight said, "Hello, good day." And the man said good day to him, but the little boy said, "Hi." And Timothy Dwight said, "How are you?" And the little boy said, "I'm fine. How are you doing?" And he said, "I'm doing very well," and walked on down the sidewalk. And when Timothy Dwight had gotten down the sidewalk a little bit, this man said to this boy, he said, "That wasn't very respectful the way you spoke to him." He said, "You shouldn't be so familiar with him." He said, "Are you aware who that is?" And the boy said, "Yeah, it's my dad." Now, folks, what I'm trying to get across to you is Jesus Christ, who is God, who is one with the Father, the creator of this world. Tonight I'm trying to tell you he's your elder brother. He took upon himself your nature. He became one with us that we might have eternal life. Listen as Maddie sang. Please take that little white card again this evening. If you didn't receive one, would you please raise your hand? Our ushers will give you one. If you didn't get one of these cards, just hold up your hand. Our ushers will give you one. Three questions tonight. The first question says, I understand that Christ existed before the world was created. If you can see from the scripture we've shared with you tonight that Jesus Christ existed before this world was ever created, then put a check by number one. Second question says, I'd like to accept Christ as my Savior. If tonight you would like to accept Jesus Christ that left heaven, left his Father, came down to this earth and took upon himself human form, that he might offer to you eternal life. Tonight, if you would like to accept him, then put a check by number two. And the third question says, I'd like to follow Christ in being baptized. Baptism is simply a public expression of my acceptance of Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. That's what it's saying. That's what it's used for. It says that I have accepted Christ as the person is placed beneath the water. It means that all their sins have been buried. And as they come up out of the water, it means that they are clean every whit. That's what it says. All of our sins have been washed away. Jesus Christ did that for you. If tonight you would like to follow Him in baptism, then put a check by number 3. Put your name, your address on it. Fill it out as Maddie sings. Tonight you understand that Jesus existed before this world was created, and put a check by number 1. If you would like to reach out in faith and accept Him as your Savior, put a check by number 2. And in following Jesus Christ, you would like to be baptized, put a check by number 3. Put your name, your address on it. We'll ask our ushers to pass to you the white containers, and if you'd just drop in your card and pencil at this time. Let me mention a couple things to you. There may be some of you that have some interest in the question of creation. There's a book out at the sales table I consider to be one of the best. It's been written on the question. I mentioned just a little bit about the halos and the rocks and stuff. There's a book out there entitled Creation's Tiny Mysteries by Dr. Robert Gentry. If you have any question about creation and about this world coming into existence as the Scripture describes, then I would highly recommend that book to you. I think you'll find it well worth your time to read that book. I have sat in his meetings. I've seen a room as big as this full of scientists and have seen no one able to answer his questions. So I would highly recommend that book to you. Okay, I've spent quite a bit of time with you trying just to make absolutely sure that you understand about Jesus Christ. We've talked tonight about His preexistence. We've spent several nights on what He has done for you and me, that He died for us, that He lived a perfect life. And we've tried to make that very clear, and I hope that's clear to you. Because starting Friday night, we're going to start moving in and applying a lot of the things that we have been learning, and particularly in Bible prophecy. And so I think you'll find that from this point on, much of the things that you've been coming and hearing will begin to fit together as we move into some very serious questions, such as Armageddon and the fall of Babylon, question of the Antichrist, Mark of the Beast. Many of those subjects that we're going to be looking at are very important, but you need to be very, very clear on Jesus Christ. And that's the reason we've spent the time we have on Him, because without Jesus Christ, none of it's worth anything. So we hope that you're clear on that. We hope you'll be back with us from night to night as we study God's Word on Friday night, resting in Christ. So we hope that all of you will be sure and be here. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee this evening that You loved us enough to leave heaven, to come to this earth, to die in our place, to give us hope. Be with each one here. Bless them and care for them. As they go to their homes and bring them back safely on Friday evening. For this we ask in Christ's name. Amen. Good night. God bless you.